thanks to our sponsor, of course. I think I have the talk with the longest name. I'm also stupid. Stupid as the trip I have to do to come here, because I came from Malaga. You can see how simple it is to come to Alicante, but I took a flight to Madrid and then to Alicante. It was long and stupid too, but it worked. I'm here. Anyway, going back to this long name, this is about solving real world problems, which is problems we have to solve, because I think we are getting paid for solving problems, not for coding. And about how we resolve these problems, in this case with React and some patterns and features that sometimes, especially lately, with so many new features and patterns and stuff, it's difficult to follow, or that's my feeling at least. You have hyper components, cloud children, context, render props, hooks, compound components, code scripting, portals, error boundaries, memoization, control props, state initializer, refs, forwarding refs, and control components, prop collection, prop headers, state reducer, prop drilling. And there is a new one. It's a joke from Ryan Flores, but he called this high order hooks, which is basically using a hook within a hook, which is an actual cool use of this, but he said, please don't use this. There's people already using this, so please don't. But anyway, every time there is a new React feature or a fancy pattern, I think it's really easy to find good documentation. I would say that even there is a lot of documentation, or too much, because the official documentation in React is fine, and then you have a lot of posts talking about the same thing. So it's easy to understand how these new features are working. But at least for me, I feel there is a lack of practical example. So it's not that easy to find proper places where you can apply these new features or patterns. As an example, when context was released, I was checking official React documentation. They have this example about you can use for adding a theme to your application, really simple way, and then I said, okay, I'm gonna check what other people is using with this. So React dark mode with context, setting up UI layout theming with context, React context API to change the theme in an app, theme switcher with React context, let's use React context API to change the theme in an app. So it's like, do we have something else which is not a to-do app or a theme for this? Anyway, I found a really cool course from Ken C, which is basically building this simple time component, and then you iterate through it the whole time working in the same way, but you are applying a lot of patterns. It's really useful, I recommend it, but at some point you feel that the component is quite simple and you are like over-engineering just for fun, which is fine for learning, but what if we can find better ways to apply this pattern to some components more complex. So this is what I'm going to talk about. I'm Mario from Malaga, as you may know. Lead of front-end web engineering at Weyler. I'll explain a little bit more about Weyler in the next slide. You can reach me out on Twitter or GitHub, or on my personal website, there is more info with me. And Weyler basically is an influencer marketing and content creator solution. And basically what we do is influencer marketing done right. So we put influencers and brands working together, so influencers build some cool stuff for them, and basically they work together for marketing and publicity. So I have as a first example of this real problem, which is a Ready group, which is not fancy at all. I complained about a theme, and now I'm going to show a Ready group. But I think is simple enough, like the target component, but it has a it's go to the next step in terms of the target only has two values. The radio group has several values, so it's fine. It's easier to find some patterns to apply here. I got this demo. This is an open repository I have. You can check the all the examples. Some spoilers about what's coming next. Usual radio group, and what I want to build here or avoid here is to use my radio group like this the whole time, writing a radio component, and between them they share all of this, like the name, the change, the check prop can be calculated in another way. The only thing that is different between them is the value they have between each. So I would like to write the radio group like this. Probably if you are using a UI framework, you are already using radio group like this, but I'm gonna implement it in different ways. Before I start coding, let's go back in time. Because I started implementing this kind of thing with React 15. I don't know if you remember how was programming in React 15, or if you ever tried. If you didn't, please don't now. We didn't have context, and actually that was one of the reasons people started using a lot Redux, for example, or other global states as MOVEX. And also it was really complex to pass props in nested levels. The other alternative you got was the unstable context API that React Team recommended not to use because they obviously was unstable. No hooks, so the class components were the only one that could have state and functional. We didn't have state at all, and actually we used to call functional component a stateless component, and that has been rephrased because it's not true anymore. Component will mount and component will update were fine. I completely forgot about them, but 1 year or 2 years ago, I couldn't imagine that one day I didn't use them. No fragment array or string rendered from the component, so we have tons of divs and span empty just because we need them for wrapping a single element or to just output a string. No error handling, no portals, so it was tough to program React 15, and that's how I'm gonna start the first version of the radio group, which is using a clone children pattern. I mean, some of these patterns I'm gonna mention is some of them are not a standard name or something like that. It's how people used to call these kind of things. It's not like a official React pattern, and people used to call it like that. So I have this, this one. This is really simple. I have this radio group, and I receive children, all the props from each child, because I'm gonna inject this prop dynamically into each child, and I'm gonna do this through React children map and React clone element. So I'm gonna clone every single child to pass every single prop and also to calculate if they are checked or not. It's quite simple to implement. And also there's no special React version needed for this. But on the other hand, it's not flexible enough because what if I need nested children? I cannot put anything between the radio group and the radio because this won't work. The clone children only works at the first level. So when context was released, it was much easier to deal with. So I can switch this component, iterate through it, and implement this way. I have the same props. Now I have a provider, which I'm gonna show now. I have the children, not cloning anything, and I have a choice here, which where I'm exposing a radio loop choice, which is basically a wrapper for each radio that I'm gonna show now. And this is a component pattern, which I find really useful because instead of having to import everything your component needs to render the children, you can just use this as a shortcut. So what is this radio group provider? It's basically I'm creating a context, and in this file I'm creating a provider and some consumers in represented in different ways. It's not doing anything special, it's just taking the children and put on the provider the values I need, and then the consumer is basically taking the context. It's a render props. If I don't receive the context, I just throw an error. You can define here some default values for the context, but I prefer not putting anything, so I see the error, because otherwise if you put the default value, it's more difficult to debug. And then I render the children with the context I receive from the consumer, and that's all. What is the radio group choice? As I said, it's a wrapper for each radio, and this one now is in charge of receiving the consumer, getting the context, extract the all the values I need, and calculate this check. It's also quite simple. It's flexible, and it's exposing that choice with a component as a shortcut. The bug point here is context could be hard to unit test, but we will go through this in the last section of the talk. And then hooks were released, so we can move this component into hooks. It's going to be exactly the same, but using hooks, which is fancy now, and is more reusable, so I have the same version in the hook. Actually, the radio group looks the same, but implementing with a function. And the one that is changing is the choice. Now, instead of using a component with a consumer, I'm using directly a hook that I created. It's in the same file as the previous consumer and the previous provider. So it's almost the same, as you can see, as the consumer. But instead of render prop the children, I'm just returning the context. And whatever component wants to use this, only needs to call this hook, and that's all. Still simple to implement, reusable hook that allows access to context within component method, because one disadvantage of using the previous consumer as a component is that it's a render prop, so you only have access to the context within that component. What if you are receiving a callback? You cannot use that callback in any of your component method. But with the hook, you can, because basically you have the hook here, so if I have something here, I have access here to the what I received from the hook. Okay? Seems really stupid, but until you realize about this, you can spend a lot of time realizing about who you can get. The bad side, again, context could be hard to unit test, and hook also. Again, we will go through this at the end of this talk. There are more things that we can do with radio, but it's not the one I want to focus. But the designer, the company I'm working for, one day sent me some designs, and basically we had to implement something like this. This is a simple version of what we received, of course. This is basically a radio group, just highlighting the selected option. This is the same, but changing the color. This is the same, but changing the color. So I need like a kind of emphasis prop, so I can say what kind of highlight I want. But also there were some options, like is hiding the radio indicator or replacing the radio indicator, depending on how you want to focus this. And also, depending on the option selected, it, only that one has to show some extra content. So you think about this, it's like a ready group, but with superpowers, because it needs the ability of showing an emphasis, and also showing conditional elements. And we can implement this with a component I call radio picker group. Sorry about this name. And I'm using the radio group I implemented before. Okay. So basically, this radio picker group is receiving two extra props, emphasis and high indicator, and I'm just rendering the previous radio group, passing all the props I'm receiving. I have a choice as before. I'll show this one soon, but I have a new component, which is a radio picker group if check. So this one basically receives the that radio choice is checked. If so, it's going to render the children. If not, it's going to render anything. This is really simple. But this one needs to be rendered inside the choice. So the choice is the one now dealing with a clone element, like the first ready group we saw. Because it needs to say to this one if it's checked or not, so it's going to render the children. So it's another simple way of implementing this. Again, here we have a children mapping with the cloning of the each child, which if you need a bestial level, you need again to apply the context pattern, but I'm not going to go through it. And I'm not cloning all the elements, I'm checking with this hacky code if it's the kind of component I want. And this is one of the disadvantages of this, because it feels really hacky to work with the children and cloning. So choice and if check shortcuts are quite handy. It's super flexible, but the children, how the children is checking the if check looks really dirty, and also the context shape is not really clear, because in this picker group, I'm using the same ready group as before, but passing two additional props. Where are these props defined? No props. Context is not defined anywhere. I would like to have some kind of context type or something like that to give some info about what context I'm expecting. But I'm using that disadvantage as an advantage, because I can just pass whatever I want. Enough about radio groups. I promised some other components too. So let's go to Weyler for doing a quick demo. We have this page, which is basically a finder for some creators in the platform. So you have several filters here. You can look for so many criteria. This starts as a 3-4 kind of filters, but at some point they were adding more and more, so we had to hide them in dropdowns. You can see that if I modify the value, nothing happened, because at the beginning, every time you modify something, it was triggering another search. So we said, okay, let's wait until the user wants to apply something here. So I need to basically, if this is modified, I highlight the apply button for the user. If closed, nothing happens, so I have to restore the previous value. Let's apply something else. Now the filters bar is updated. But I need the apply filters outside of the dropdown, because I need to show this filters apply bar. Sometimes I need to highlight the content, the results I'm retrieving. I also need the filters for sending that as a data to the API. So I extracted this into a global state. I'm using Redux, but Redux itself doesn't matter for this. It's just something outside. And the last feature is when you remove from the outside, now the dropdown has to be updated. So if I clear all, the dropdown is updated too. It doesn't look like complex stuff to implement, but there are some small details that are not so easy to expose. So we need to build here a dropdown that is not closing when you select an item inside or you click an item inside, which is the usual behavior of a dropdown. That probably depends on which dropdown component you use. Manage a double state, draft, and apply, so I can handle something waiting for being applied. Maintain the draft state until it's applied, or discard it if it's canceled, discard it if it's closed, and keep the values up to date when they are changed from outside. And of course, this has to be built in a generic way, because you have seen there are three or four dropdowns there, and we have more like that in the rest of the platform. So I have a small representation of that. Here. So if I cancel, it goes back. If I apply something, it's applied here. I clear, and it's cleared here. I use four ways of doing this, but the first one was in here because it was basically using Redux with a double slide for dealing with the draft and the applied value. And that's not technically React, so I'm going to pass to the next one when we got access to context API. So I built this component called actionable dropdown using children refs. You are not gonna see these children refs anywhere because it's something I built the first time I worked with the context. It's completely wrong, but I'm really proud of it because it's working. So the first version for this is this component. It's really huge because it's mixing how the dropdown is rendered, how the dropdown is dealing if it has to close or open, and how the dropdown is restoring the draft data or applying the draft data. Of course, I'm putting here a component that at this version is being implemented with a higher order component, which is a new way of getting the context. I'm going through this one because it's similar to the class component for getting the context, but now this is a high order component pattern, so I need a function rendering, generating a component. And here, instead of passing everything I receive from the context, I'm passing two things. The onChange for each of these items that you can edit in the dropdown, and also a callback to be able to get the reference of the component. Why I need this? Because I did some weird things here, and I thought, okay, I need the value of each item, so instead of putting the value in the dropdown and then passing each option or each value to each child, I generate this array of children, and then I'm passing a callback to get the reference and get the reference of the instance, because if you pass the ref to an instance, to a component, sorry, you get the reference of that instance, not something from the top. So I say, okay, I'm gonna save all the child I have. I'm gonna put on this array. So for example, when I click on cancel, I need to iterate the children array and restore each of each child. And of course, the editable item, which is the child, needs to follow like a pattern. So this looks like object-oriented programming, not something functional. But as I say, this works, okay? With this first iteration, we avoid duplicated data in Redux and keep the draft in a local state. The higher the component provided, implemented, allow you to separate the context data from the actual component components, so you can use the component component separately if you need it. And also this force all editable items to follow a standard value and shape props naming, which is actually quite important because usually some people try to put an, for a date picker, you pass the value through the date prop and you get the new value through the on date change, but why not just pass for every kind of input value and change? I realize about that with this implementation. But this component is really weird. It has the wrong data workflow. It's not really React's way of getting editable children values. It's keeping refs from children into an array, which is dangerous, because if you don't handle it properly, you can get more and more children, repeated children added to the array. And it has an issue because every time I'm closing or opening the model, sorry, the dropdown here, I'm restoring the value. But what about when the dropdown is closed and the filters are clear also? The dropdown is not being refreshed. I'm not getting any issue with the current version, but maybe it can lead to some future issues. So this is how weird it looks, the workflow of this component. Is this familiar to you? Exactly, it's the same as the trip I did from Malaga to Alicante. It was really easy to get the proper workflow, but I did the completely wrong way. So let's fix this. Let's do the actionable dropdown using hooks first. So it's working in the same way, but it's gonna help us to realize how we can refactor it properly and also to find more patterns to apply. I'm not gonna show the code, it's on the demo I'm showing, but this version doesn't work. Doesn't work because if we migrate the editable item to a functional component, the reference I'm passing to the children is not working because functional component doesn't have reference. So when I was doing this, everything exploded, so editable item has to remain as a class component. I could migrate at least the wrapper of the dropdown to a functional component. So we need to find another way to solve this. By the way, you are going to see in the code from now on that I'm not using use callback and use memo that much. It's true that it's memoizing the function and the values, but it has a cost. So I only try to use it when I find an issue or when returning things from hooks, because you don't want to return a different callback every single time to force another component to be returned. Actually, a couple of days ago, this guy called Matthew Gersman, I don't know if you read the tweet, that he was trying to break React until until how many tags React could render. He got, I think, like 10,000 H1 tags. And after that, he did a research. And basically, anonymous function doesn't make any change in the performance of your app. Anyway, going back to the actionable dropdown, as I said, I need to put the state in the parent component, not on each children. That's the lifting state up. And also I'm gonna use a state initializer, which is attending to the state, the local state you have, to initialize it with the what you receive from outside. So from this one. Well, the editable item now looks in looks simpler and is more readable. It's just it only passing the new value to the children component, and from these values, which is the whole object of filters value, I'm getting with an item key, I'm getting the value I need for the editable thing inside, and now the whole logic is in the pattern, it's in the actionable lockdown. I'm using these three hooks with the state, one for keeping the dropdown open, if it's pending to apply the draft values, which is the same as the class component version. This is the state initializer, and you see the hook use effect, so I react to change in the applies values received from outside, so every time they are changed, I basically reset the draft values. And then everything else is the same. I have this handle setting different states. This looks nice because it has the correct data workflow. It's a proper reactive way of working with editable item children, not with that weird stuff about the arrays and the refs. Not giving that refs in the array as mentioned, and now with that use effect, I'm reinitializing the state, so it's restoring the values while the dropdown is closed. Okay. But points here: the logic for updating the component is difficult to follow because this use effect seems weird at first sight, and also handling the dropdown tiling has a lot of setting state depending on a lot of things. So also the local state is reinitialized with the props from outside are updated. But good news, these two things are actually a good opportunity for the usual user. When your state depends on another state or some props from outside, it's a good site for using the user, and also if the logic update is difficult to follow, it means you're probably close to using a hook for user user. This is the last implementation I got here. So the reducer, first of all, I'm going to show the reducer. If you are familiar with Redux, this is the same. I have some action. Open the model, closing the model, setting a value, applying a value, restoring a value. Then I have the reducer itself, which receives a state and an action with a type and a payload. So when the dropdown is open, I just set open to true. If the is closed, open to false, is not pending to be applied, and values are restored from the payload. So this code is much easier to read in terms of how the action are editing the state. But now for using this, I will have to use directly the dispatch for dispatching action in my component. I did it in a prior version, but I didn't like all that code inside the component. So I generate a complex custom hook, which is use actionable dropdown, which is gonna generate the what usually in Redux is the action creators. So you're gonna generate some callbacks wrapping the dispatch and maintain the initial values, the old values, and these are these callbacks for dispatching this reducer action. I'm using the use effect and use callback here because this is a hook and I don't want to re-render components using this hook unnecessarily. And then I return the state and action creators. So now the dropdown looks much clean. I only have to use the hook. I receive the state. I get from it what I need. And then from action, I got the proper action. When the dropdown is toggling, if it's going to be open, open. If not, close it. When this cancel is clicked, then close the dropdown. So this is much easier to read, and the component is more simple. It's split bit by bit. So this one, concerns are separated, the component logic is simplified and is more readable. The actionable drop-down behavior plus the draft values are extracted into a hook for reusability, so if you need to re-implement the same mechanism in another component, you already have the behavior. You already need to implement how it should look like. The bad things here is reducer and action needs some knowledge before starting working with them. And this pattern with the use reducer is not so easy to spot where you can use it. Summary, a recap about what we got. Inject props with cron children, exposing children with compound components, using the context with different versions of consumers, with a component, a hybrid component, a hook, how not to use children, hooks plus a state initializer to keep a local draft, and how and when to use the user, and a custom complex hook for generating action creators for our reducer. Testing time, this is what I mentioned before. This is the last area of the talk. I used to test all this with Ensign, and refactoring all these components was a nightmare with Ensign, and it's basically impossible. Ensign is a utility that makes you easier to test your React component's output, but the key thing is you can manipulate the component itself within your test. I don't know if that's what we need, because we are testing implementation details, so if my component is refactored and is working in the same way, the tests are going to be broken, only because under the hood is working a different way. Actually, that's not what I want for my test. It's shallow rendering, so I don't know what's the deal about that. It's giving you utils for manipulating the component itself, so for testing the component, you have to redo the logic in some way, because you need to start inspecting the inside of the component. Usually, you use snapshot testing for it. I don't know what's the point about this now, because if the user is seeing the same and can interact with it in the same way, do we care about how is rendering the snapshot? Doesn't matter if it's a div with a role group or a field set. It should. It's hard to maintain because of this reason. So usually you have a component connected to other things, like let's say Redux. With Ensign, we test each one individually, but we never test the connection. And this is what happens when you do these kind of things. It's like when you test and you start using everything together, yes, they are working individually, but then together, it's impossible to test if they are working or not. So what should we test then? Ryan Flores has the answer. The only two inputs, well, a unit test should send inputs to a unit and then assess the output. What are these inputs and this output? The input is or a probe from the programmer or an interaction from the user. An output is the element rendered from the component or the cipher, like an API call or getting something from the local storage. For this, React Test Library is the proper library to use for your tests. I hope people here know about React Testing Library. How many of you heard about it? Okay. I have with that a lot of people. React Testing Library is providing a utility function on top of ReactDOM, which is a utility that provides utils for querying the DOM. So this library encourages better testing practices, and the primary principle is the more your tests mirror the actual behavior from the user, the more confidence they can give you. So React Testing Library is testing behavior with the DevProps and user interaction. It's rendering component in a simulated DOM with JS DOM or in the browser. It's giving utils for querying elements like user find these elements. Improves accessibility of your components because basically you have to query things inside your components with what the user sees. It's easy to maintain because you are testing the behavior, so it doesn't matter how it works under the hood. All the tests can be easily used as a use cases documentation, and just in case, it can also be a snapshot tested, but with the real DOM output, not the shadow rendering. So the same example as before, we can still test this, but we also test this. So I don't have another funny GIF about doors for now. It has some downsides, of course. You need to switch your mentality for writing the test. The learning curve is complex and long because you got queries about how to get the elements from your component and what components or what element you want to match. And also, you need to learn a lot of things about accessibility, which is a really cool thing, but at the beginning, it's hard. Difference between unit and integration tests are not really clear, but should we care? They are tests. I'm testing my components. I was able to iterate through all that component with this test, so it feels great. You can get weird situation with async queries, which means an async query is when you have something appearing in the UI, but you need to wait for it because something has to happen. And the act method. I don't know if you heard before about ACT, but basically it's a React DOM testing util that you need to use in your test when rendering in a fake DOM. But React Testing Library is dealing with it for you in most of the cases, but sometimes you can get like an ACT warning that means that probably you are not waiting for some components appearing. I cannot test the styles with CSS modules. That cannot be tested with enzyme, so it's not a big deal, but CSS in JS can be tested. And it's complex to test components that are measuring the height or width, but again, with enzyme it's not possible to do that here. I have some text example in the repository. Everything is tested with the React Testing Library using the same block of tests, iterating through each component, so all the tests I'm using, the same test cases. And to finish some tips, because I've talked about how to iterate through these components, how to test them, how good is to refactor with the React Testing Library, but I don't want you to arrive to the office on Monday and start refactoring everything, please don't. So do not refactor just because. Instead, refactor when you are revisiting a component because you need to fix something or you need to update something. Or you need to update the component because you need to use something else you cannot at the moment. Like if you have a class component and you already have a fancy hook, you cannot use it inside the class component, so maybe you want to refactor it. Probably that's a good time for it. Do not refactor for extracting a pattern the first time. Instead, use the rule of three, which means the first time you do it, the second time you copy and paste it, and the third time is when you extract. Because otherwise, you can have the wrong extraction. How should I refactor? Obviously, with enzyme, it's impossible because you write test, then you refactor your component, and then you have to rewrite the test. What's the point about doing the refactor like this? Instead of this, write a reliable test with React Testing Library, refactor your components, refactor again if you find things that you can improve and implement new features if needed, but after the first test, you shouldn't need to rewrite any of them. Here you can find the reference of most of the things I talked about here. And just to finish my talk, I thought about Sarah Vieira friend, but she said on her Twitter, I hate coding because it feels so good to get something to work, but then if you try to explain what you did, it doesn't sound hard or cool.
Yeah.
So that was all. Thank you.